Hey Metal Maniacs, this is Jovita from Metal on Metal Records, and you are tuned into Dave Softee's Metal Meltdown on Metal Messiah Radio.
Metal Maniacs, here we go. Please help me welcome to Metal Messiah Radio, hailing from Italy, owner of outstanding underground metal label, Metal on Metal Records, and amazing graphics designer. Let's turn the spotlight on and hear it for the one and only Jovita Kaminska-Peruzzi. Welcome to the Metal Meltdown, Jovita. Thank you for taking the time to be here. How are you doing out there? And thank you for joining us in the chat room.
Hey, I'm doing great, thank you, and cheers for having me, of course.
I'm looking forward to this. If you remember, at the end of last season, I told you we would do something special for you, so here we are, and it's perfect timing. So, I don't know if you're aware, but we have something in common with Metal on Metal Records That is that our 15th anniversary is coming up. So all of us here on Metal Messiah Radio want to wish Metal on Metal Records a happy 15th anniversary. We actually started sometime in January of 2008. And I want to know more about when Metal on Metal Records started up. I'm thinking that it happened around the same time, but can you fill us in on all the details about the beginnings of Metal on Metal Records?
Sure. There is no real precise date to speak of. It wasn't really January, but the idea to start the record label was actually born in late 2007, and we brought it to life in 2008. And our first releases were actually out in early April, at the 10th edition of the Keep It True Festival. It was our compilation, our first compilation, the only one we did actually without the Compendium of Metal title, and it was just sort of a promo in a cardboard sleeves edition, without a booklet or proper cover. Then there was the double CD of US power thrash band Catch 22, Soul Reaper Revolution Devolution. And the third item we released was something we did only twice, actually. It was a Keep It True Festival History book, which we published for the 10th edition. Like I said, it was the 10th edition of the festival at that time. The idea to start the label, it was my husband's idea. I was quite reluctant and skeptical for quite a long time, because as an artist, I never thought I could run any kind of a business. I didn't think it was my kind of thing. And it took him quite some time to convince me. But then he promised to take care of the mundane things like accounting, and finally he managed to convince me. And as an experienced graphic designer who worked for many years for board games companies, he also does all layouts for our releases, while I do some of the covers. And
very nice.
The fact, yeah, it's in the end, it's my job actually. It's my main job, the one kind I studied for. And the fact that I also had lots of contacts in the true metal scene, the bands for which I painted covers, I took photos of, and also some people from festival organizers for whom I designed the logos, and some press people. So this helped for sure to start the label. It made it a little bit easier at the start. Yeah, it was also one of the arguments that Simone used, that because you already have the contact, so let's do it. And we started the label basically because we wanted to contribute something of value to the metal scene of which we have been. At the time, we had been already part as fans for many, many years. I mean, Simona since early 80s and me since 88. And he was also working for a short time as a journalist for an Italian magazine, writing reviews, reports. And I was involved in the scene also as a, like I said, as a cover artist, as a designer, and as a photographer. But that was not enough for us, and we thought, you know, there are really plenty of talented bands which, you know, they carry on the flame, the torch of the older of the bands from the 80s, deserve more recognition. So yeah, we thought we could somehow help in promoting and releasing their albums. And yeah. And by the way,
that.
Yes, and happy 15th anniversary to Metal Messiah Radio.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that too. Now, you just said something about the true metal. So if you can, Yowita, please inform the listeners who may not be aware of Metal on Metal Records, what kind of music you have on your label, what kind of styles and specialties of metal on metal records you have. So my understanding, you have a wide array of metals on your label, from heavy to doom to U.S. power to thrash, speed, black thrash, and even death. But there's probably more than I'm even speaking of. So if you can, I would like you to tell all the listeners out there exactly what metal on metal records offers.
Yeah, you're right. You know what we are all about, and we made it actually quite clear, and in a few places we list the styles, so everything is clear. We are focused on old school metal. It's a generic term we use because it's the metal that ranges from a classic heavy metal, US power, thrash, speed, black thrash, mostly traditional and epic doom. And it's just because we are the most passionate about this kind of styles, genres of metal. You can also find a few that have some hard rock and progressive elements, and even a technical death metal and old school death metal. However, they are not as representative for what we are releasing as a label. And you will definitely not find any modern crap on our among our releases, because what I mean by modern, of course, it's a little bit subjective, because what I call modern, and I mean the styles that came already in the 90s, which as I have written on our contact page. Okay, just to quote, because it's a list what we are not into. So no new metal, no hardcore, no metalcore, not any core for that matter, no groovy modern tough guy joke metal, no screamo, no emo, no alternative, no post anything, no gothic, and that includes also female operatic singers in general, and no glam, no industrial, no grind, no ambient, no drone, no sludge, no grunge, no punk, and or any other mainstream, any other styles that mainstream media try to sell as metal, mainstream, let's say, music media, but either have nothing or almost nothing to do with real metal.
I appreciate that. Of course. And that's what you call true metal, right? All that's not true metal. All that is not true.
We actually prefer to say old school metal, because true metal is a little bit, maybe sounds a little bit more elitist. However, it could be also, well, however you call it. I mean, yeah. Real metal. I would say maybe more real metal, or the metal, which has roots in the 80s, basically.
Got you. Thank you for explaining.
We are also not into some styles which are not the ones I mentioned previously, but Europower, this kind of more melodic power metal style with more keyboards and symphonic and the European power metal, no, but US power metal very much.
Yeah, so we call that kind of metal cheesy metal. It's very cheesy.
Yeah, cheesy metal. And where the keyboards are sometimes more important than guitars, and also we are not into black metal in general. The the second wave of black metal and whatever came after, symphonic or depressive suicidal black metal and something. So that's not our stuff. However, we are very much into the first wave. In the bands. So if a band plays in this kind of raw 80s style, if they have Venom, Hellhammer, Celtic Frost influences, then we can be interested very much in them. And death metal, it's also like, okay, I'm very picky about this. My husband likes more probably than me, but we are not into brutal death metal, or we like just the classic old school stuff in the vein of Unleashed, Death, Asphyx, Autopsy. These are just the four of the most favorite bands, actually. So, it still boggles my mind, that it seems like it's so clearly written everywhere, not just on our website, on Facebook and but on the website, where is the contact? And we still got so many submissions. We received so many submissions from the bands, which playing those styles which I mentioned we are not into, clearly. But, you know, I don't know. It's either people don't read or they don't
most
care,
likely.
Or they don't take the time to familiarize themselves with our releases and bands. So, yeah, they are basically wasting their time.
Yeah.
If they don't know, I mean, they don't have a group, probably, so.
Yeah, they just keep trying. That's it.
Yeah.
They just keep trying.
And, what else? And yeah, as fans, we have very specific tastes, but quite similar. I mean, me and Simone and myself have quite very, very similar tastes in music, and we are not very known to be open-minded about it. But as a label, we are even more picky, so we basically signed bands that really whose music really blew us away when we heard it, and you know, we like so many bands, but that's just not enough to only like the bands. It has to be much more, and of course there are several other factors we consider when deciding whether or not to start working with a band. And in general, since the start, we always say that we value quality over quantity.
Good saying.
So, therefore, you know, we have actually only a few releases every year, usually 6-7, plus the annual compilation. Though, unfortunately, in the last 3 years, there have been fewer. The pandemic didn't help the situation.
Right.
And, yeah, so, you know, it's just important to us, because if I cannot stand behind the band's music 100%, if we cannot write honest words of praise and recommendation about a band, then this band will not be on our roster. It's simple as that. We have to be completely convinced to try to convince people why we chose this band, why we think they are worth checking out and supporting. So it's the label is basically for the people, the like-minded people who keep the old metal spirit alive, and musicians who play their music with heart and with balls, and the fans of the rough. And for us, the attitude and the honesty, enthusiasm in the music are much more important than originality of style or innovative ideas. And one thing, I don't know if it's okay, one more thing I can add.
Sure.
That what sets us apart from some other labels is that we focus only on currently active bands and their new albums. In general, we are not interested in re-releasing any obscure or obscure or less obscure stuff from the past.
I got you.
We leave this to other labels. There are enough of them specializing in that. And there were only two exceptions, actually. However, it was previously unreleased stuff in the case of Bitter End and pre-Malaya Rage, and early Malaya Rage demos. We just prefer to promote active bands and get their new music out to the metalheads. In our opinion, they deserve more attention. I mean, they deserve attention more than bands which are long split up, whose members may not be into metal anymore, and who may not even care about what they did in the past musically. And we always try to sign bands which are active live, though unfortunately sometimes this doesn't work. And bands that had been playing many gigs prior to us offering them a deal They stopped doing it, or even worse, they split up soon after their album is out, which actually happened to us a couple of times, and this was quite upsetting, really, because, you know, you believe in a band. You believe in a band enough to invest in them, to help promoting them, and then this shit happens, so... Yeah, but unfortunately, we don't have a crystal ball, so... you never know what happens.
It's true, but this is life, and I have a lot of respect for you. I totally understand how you feel about that, and now we have a perfect time to talk about your latest releases on Metal on Metal. We have a couple of interviews I'm getting ready to do for Metal on Metal Records. We have a band from Spain, Nugamanti. They have a new album out there called Summon the Devil. We have from Malta, Albert Bell's Psycho Sanctus with their latest release, Sword of Fuewa. I was saying that name wrong. Albert Bell corrected me on how to say that. Fuewa. I was saying something else, you know? Yeah.
It's
you said, but
it's a French word, yeah. Firboa, I think.
Yes.
I'm not even 100% sure.
It is. That's what he said. But it doesn't roll off my tongue too easy. And then you have a band from the UK that you're recommending me to get with for an interview. Arkham Witch with a Sword Against Death. You're telling me that lyrically they would be a great topic to talk with them about. So we'll see what happens with that. Plus, you mentioned about your compilations. You have a Metal Volume 15 of your compendium.
Mm-hmm.
So, Yoida, please talk a bit to us about these new releases and how was it in signing these bands to your label?
Sure. So, starting with the first one you mentioned, Nigromante is one of our new signings this year, a band I was actually not familiar with until I was contacted by Choco, the vocalist, guitarist, and bass player of the band, earlier in February this year. It turned out they were formed in 2003, but had only one album out in 2014. Anyway, the songs, the new songs he sent us convinced us right away. We love the compositions and the traditional approach to the recording, which resulted in really authentically old-school sounding heavy metal album. And, you know, when we press play over and over again, it's always a good sign. And that was the case, too. So,
excellent.
So offering them a deal was just a formality. And the fact also that Choco himself is a dedicated metalhead and supporting the scene since, I think, since quite early 2000s. He organized many concerts in Spain, including Pounding Metal Fest. It's the organization, like a sort of a heavy metal club, quite active there, as far as I know. Unfortunately, I've never been there, but hopefully one day. And so the fact that he's really into the scene and supporting also other bands is something we really appreciate. And as far as the music on Summon the Devil is concerned, in case you haven't heard it yet, to my ears it's got influences from Merciful Fate, Early Running Wild, Anvil, Judas Priest, Angel Witch, while the vocals definitely resemble Chris Boldenthal from Gravedigger. So that's in short.
Yeah. Now that you mention it, yeah, that's the resemblance. I couldn't place it, but yeah, that's what it is.
That was actually the first thing I thought about, the resemblance of the vocals.
Yeah, I couldn't place it. I couldn't place it, but you just placed it for me. Thank you. You're right. Good ears. Yeah. I couldn't think of it. Yeah. Very good.
Mm-hmm. With the other two bands, we go much more way back and have released many CDs for them already, especially with Albert. As my friendship with him started already in 2004 at Headbangers Open Air Festival in Germany, where he played with his, at the time, main band, Forsaken, epic doom metal, one of the most established Maltese bands, and for whom I later actually painted two cover arts. So, and we kept in contact for all these years. And in 2007, he told me about this new band he started, called Nomad Sun, and he sent me two songs. And we were absolutely blown away with this traditional doom metal with Hammonds. So, actually, they contributed in huge part to our decision to start the label. They contributed in huge part to our decision to start the label because it was just too good. Mm-hmm. And,
that's cool.
We were lucky, to see quite a few Nomad Sun shows, mostly in Malta, where we went probably 10 times or more, mainly for the awesome Malta Doom Metal Festival, which Albert organized, from 2009 to 2018, I think, was the last edition. And but also we saw them in Germany and the Netherlands. We went to a mini tour with them, like 5 shows in a row.
Nice.
And Albert himself actually is quite an institution when it comes to Maltese metal scene. He's a very respected figure in the Maltese metal scene. And anyway, 3 Nomad Sun albums later, in 2014, we released the debut album of Albert's solo project, Sacrosanctus, on which he had been actually working for already 3 years. And it wasn't what most would expect from the veteran of the doom metal scene. It was more of a return to the roots when it comes to his influences and musical career. More early black thrash was mixed with some doom and heavy metal and a little bit of Motorhead style rock and roll. And it was also the first time you could hear Albert singing, because until then he was only playing bass.
Gotcha.
He was singing and playing guitar also. And this darker and more extreme, more evil sounding side of Albert's musical expression appealed to us right away, so we didn't have to think twice, and we offered him a deal. And it resulted now in 4 Sacrosanctus albums already, and full-length albums, and which all of them are concept albums also, which is quite interesting. What's worth mentioning is that on the new one, on Sword of Fervua, Albert got 24 guests, mostly to contribute some guitar solos or vocals. Among them, Jeff Mantas, Dan from Venom, now Venom Inc., Alan Jones, Pagan Altar, John Gallo from Orodruin, Francesco Sozzi from Dark Quarterer, Marcus Gidel from Avatarium, Doomsday Kingdom, Candlemas, and most of his Forsaken and Nomad Sun bandmates.
And that's crazy. Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah, he was really, as you, when you talked to him, I'm pretty sure he talked a lot about this, how important it was for him to
yes.
have all these guests. And so it was very cool. Every song features some other musicians also. I'd compare his music mostly to Venom, early Celtic. Okay.
It's okay.
Okay. Sometimes my tongue gets stuck.
I'll cut that out. Don't worry.
Need to
no
drink
problem.
Some water.
Yeah, definitely drink water. You're doing a lot of talking, so yeah. Yeah.
No. That's good.
He also talked about we talked about his artwork being very medieval. It tied into the music very well.
Yeah, we always I always do a lot of research for his albums, and they are all booklets are full of old artworks which are connected, which depict some scenes, historical scenes or historical figures, depending on each lyric, of course. Same with the cover arts. So basically we are using a lot of old art, copyright free art from public domain, from the past centuries. As far as the music is concerned, I would compare it mostly to Venom, early Celtic Frost, mid-era Bathory, Motorhead, St. Vitus, Sabbath from UK, quite a bit vocally also, the Czech Black Thrash legends Root and Thor, as well as some 90s Hellenic black metal bands like Zemiel. However, in this case, actually more the later albums of him, so of Zemiel.
Mm-hmm. I got you. Thank you for explaining that.
And Arkham Witch is the British band founded in 2008, with which we started working in 2012, and for whom we released most CDs, as they are very prolific and got a good following in the scene. So we even made an exception for them and released a series of 3 EPs. And re-released the remastered demo, apart from releasing now already 3 full lengths. Because normally, also one thing, as a label, we basically always refuse to release EPs and just focus on the full length albums. But this was an exception. And we also met them many times, and so many of their shows. In the UK, in Germany, Malta, Denmark, some festivals. And yeah, they are some of the coolest guys to hang out with, definitely.
That's cool.
It's always cool, yes. It's always cool when the musicians are also, I also, great as people, simply as this. So
that's nice.
Uh-huh. And their new album, Swords Against Death, is their fourth full length, and it's the long awaited because it was announced and delayed already since 2017.
Well, since before COVID. Okay.
Wow. Yeah, we have waited for a long time with this one, and I'm sure the fans were also quite getting impatient. Anyway, it's the follow-up to the 2015's I Am Providence, which was a bit different in style. It had some melodic punk influences and much shorter songs. But here they come back to their earlier quirky style. Their very unique mix of new wave of British heavy metal influenced heavy metal, with some doom and rawer kind of punk, even a little bit of thrash metal, which resulted in 10 absolutely epic songs, in my opinion, that make you pump your fist up in the air and sing along instantly. At least that's the effect the songs have on us. So, and definitely something that fans of Siri Tango, Hell, Manila Road, Deep Switch, Witchfinder General, in this case also Thin Lizzy, St. Vitus always, Pentagram, and as well as the other earlier and doomier band of the vocalist and bass player and the drummer, The Lamp of Thought, should check. I mean, these are the probably the closest comparisons I can come up with. The Lamp of Thought is like the doomier twin of Arkham Witch, and they often played as Arkham Witch. They played some songs of The Lamp of Thought live, and even the EPs were sort of Arkham Witch covering The Lamp of Thought. It was a little bit confusing, but in the end, the band decided let's release it under the Arkham Witch name, even though they are the songs of The Lamp of Thought, the other band of main musicians and composer. And
okay, that's interesting.
Maybe you know, in the past The Lamp of Thought maybe were a little bit more known when they were on Miskatonic Records, Miskatonic Productions. Anyway, but they were quite a short-lived band in the end. and the Arkham Witch is now, I think, more known, actually, so. And, yeah, as for Compendium of Metal, volume 15, it's just the latest in the series of our annual compilations. Apart from songs taken from the albums we released last year, and songs from the albums we already released this year, with the exception of Arkham, which actually, because in their case we featured a song from their self-released digital-only EP on this compilation. You can find their demo version of a new Eternal Thirst song that will be out on their next album, and a rough mix version of a song by a new band we have signed named Kingdom of Tyrants, which the band was founded by two Steel Assassin guitarists, Kevin Curran and Mike Mooney, and featuring also the legendary Malaya Rage vocalist Mike Munro and Malaya Rage drummer Stu Dowing.
So wow, that's interesting.
New band, nice. But with musicians who are definitely known in the scene, and
yeah,
it was really great to hear also Mike Munro after many years back behind the microphone. So, and last but definitely not least, there's an exclusive song by the killer German black thrash band Vomit Division, whose next album we plan to release early next year. And unfortunately, we already see at the moment that the new albums of Kingdom of Tyrants and Eternal Thirst will have to be moved to 2023 because it's already long past deadline, and unfortunately neither band have finished the albums. Not sure even when they will have the masters, so there is just no chance for having it released and this year.
As you say, shit happens. Yeah, as you say.
Yeah, shit happens. And in this case was really like, oh my god, so it's only like 3 albums this year plus the compilation. It's the least we have ever had. But what can we do? Sometimes it just happens like this, you know. Cannot force the band to, hey, you have to hurry up. I mean, yeah, we can tell them to try to hurry up to, you know, but sometimes it's the scheduling problems with the studio and the work and everything else. Obviously, for most of the bands, it's just a hobby, so they have other things they have to take care of also, so.
Yeah, I think I think I noticed Homestyle Surgery. There's a song on the compilation by them as well, right?
On this compilation, yes, because Homestyle Surgery, yes, we released last year, which means there is a song on this compilation also. Yes, like
good,
I said,
good. I love that band from Finland. They're a really great band, great sound. Reminds me a lot of like Gamma Bomb from Ireland. Great, fun sounding band. Great lyrically, vocally, and instrumentally. They're, you know, musicianship wise, they're really a great band.
Mm-hmm. They're very technical, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my favorite band on your label, I think. Outside of Attacker. Yeah, outside of Attacker.
Okay. Yeah, they are great. I hope they are working on some new stuff now, so. Because the last album was very short.
Yeah.
But hopefully they will also get to play.
Let's hope so. Yeah. Is there anything else you wanted to mention about the compilation?
Yes, so like I said, the albums, the last two albums which were planned for this year will have to be out next year. Unfortunately, you have to wait. And as for the compilation, you can always get it for half of the regular CD price, that is for €6, or for €4 if CDs together with any other CD or LP from our shop, or digitally from our Bandcamp page, where you also we uploaded, as a bonus, a PDF with the complete layout of the CD. So
nice. That's very nice. Thank you. Thank you for explaining that to the listeners. And also, Yuita, would you please share with us some of your proudest moments in being the owner of Metal on Metal Records, as well as some of your all-time favorite releases from the past and the present on your label? Because I'm sure you're proud of a lot of the music that you have released.
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit difficult to answer because, you know, we've released, there have been so many. We've released over 100 CDs now, a little bit over 100 if you consider compilations among them. And we have worked with nearly 50 bands until now, over these years. So it's a little bit like, you know, having to say which child is your favorite one.
I got you, yeah.
I have no children, but, you know, so I consider the bands like all the releases.
Yeah, I got you.
Okay, so but personally, I would mention three bands for one reason. Because I was a big fan of them back in the day, which in my case was actually in the 90s, in the early 90s. So it was a huge privilege to be working with them as the label, as well as the cover artist. So the first and the most important one for me is the German black thrash band, Black Thrash Pioneers, founded in 1983, Outrage, who released only four demos in the 80s before splitting up, and then coming back in 2004, just to self-release, but only on CDRs, some old re-recorded material, and later some new stuff as well. And when I finally decided to contact them in early 2011, it was, I contacted them just as a fan to buy everything they have released, that they had available basically. And it just happened without me knowing. It just happened to be 2 weeks before what was supposed to be their final show, which made me really sad because it was like, okay, I'm just contacting this band, finally, I'm getting in touch. And I was actually thinking, maybe they could write some new stuff, so maybe we could release it, but I had no idea about them planning to call it quits, actually. So, but I'm so happy I managed to talk them into not quitting. And the long story short, three CD releases followed. And the first one being a re-recording of their 80s songs, as well as two tapes we released, and then vinyl reissues of their demos through another label, and several shows and festival appearances also abroad for them, in Denmark, in Malta, Netherlands. So this gave me really the biggest satisfaction as far as the label's work is concerned, because I always considered Outrage as one of the most underrated bands that I know, at least. And like an obscure and forgotten first wave of black metal treasure. And, you know, to introduce them to many more people and to see how some of them fell head over heels for them, this really, really gave me a lot of joy. And sadly, their lineup problems in 2018, the band is now on hiatus, and but I'm still hoping to revive them again, maybe at least for one festival appearance next year.
pretty much save that band, and hopefully they don't disappoint you.
Yeah, I hope they can consider. I mean, it's just the two young guys, the drummer and the bass player, who actually quit. So now they are the two original guys, the composer, the guitarist, and the vocalist, who are the most important for the band, but they need the complete band, of course, so. Whether they find the new members or maybe the old ones come back, we'll see.
Maybe they'll form a new band.
Maybe they find new members, but it's a bit difficult because I don't think they are really trying, you know. And
well, that's not good. If they're not trying.
But I have to tell them about the festival, which we are thinking about, and actually the festival wants them, so we'll see.
I wish you the best of luck with them.
Mm-hmm. And the second band I was a big fan of for many, many years is Attacker, whom I first saw and met in 2004 at the Keep It True Festival in Germany also, where I took photos of them and where our friendship started. And still before we started working together as the label and the band in late 2012, when the band finally found a fitting vocalist in Bobby Lederlang's Lucas after a long hiatus, I had painted two cover arts for them, for their previous albums, The Unknown and compilation, sort of a best of Standing the Test of Time. And yeah, it was an honor to work with this US semi-underground legend, and who, unlike most bands from the 80s, didn't change their style, and to release for them two albums and one EP of top-notch quality songs, which, you know, just seeing how these releases were received and also witnessing firsthand how the band was received at several European festivals was really a big satisfaction as well.
Did you release, when you released the Attacker albums, did you do the cover art for those albums too?
Yes.
Okay. I thought so. Mm-hmm. I thought so.
Giants of Canaan, Scenes of the World, and Armor of the Gods. The EP.
Very nice. I thought so. I just want to be sure. And yeah, maybe the future will bring Attacker back to Metal on Metal Records.
Who knows?
anyway, hope so.
And the third band is Malaya Rage, the U.S. power thrash metal veterans from Boston. We were chuffed when they accepted our offer to release their album in 2011. In their case, it didn't sound like their classic albums, but it was still a very solid offering with the great riffs of Tony Nichols, who turned out to be one of the nicest and most easygoing guys to work with. And which is also very important always. And we released also their following two full lengths, and as well as a compilation of mostly unreleased early Malaya Rage and pre-Malaya Rage material that we called Before the Kill, because it was all songs or material from before their 88 debut, Kill to Survive. And for them, I also painted the covers for.
Oh, very good. Very good. Thank you.
Not all the albums, but Kill to Survive and Dead to the World. And there were also other bands from the 80s, like Dark Quarter, Emerald from Holland, from the Netherlands, Heretic, and Bitter End, whom we were thrilled to work with, but I had not been a fan of them for as long as of the three aforementioned bands. And so I just discovered them some years later in my metal journey. So as you can imagine, their impact was on me was not as strong, but still great bands, of course. And the proudest moments, I don't know, I could say they could probably include the releasing albums which were really successful and needed to be repressed or re-released, as the initial 1,000 copies were not enough, which is not that common in the underground. That's nowadays, at least in the past, the CDs were selling a little bit better. I mean, we can see the difference over the 15 years. But anyway, so that included starting with the newest one, Midnight Priest, Aggressive Hauntings, released in 2019, repressed in 2020, and sold out now. Arkham Witch, Legions of the Deep, the re-release is also nearly sold out. Attacker, Giants of Canaan, that we repressed just like, I think, the next month after releasing, when we realized it was not enough. Well, I Raged at the World was reissued with a little bit different version, the same as the previous albums, that is Metal Lawbreaker, Nomad Sun First Light, and Heat and Damnations. We just did second editions, which were a little bit different, some bonus tracks and slightly altered cover arts.
All right, thank you for filling us in with all that information and taking the time to tell us about this. Like you said, all these bands are like your children. It's hard to pick what your favorite is, but I appreciate you taking the time in doing that. And
I could talk a lot about this, but there is not enough time for.
We only have a 3-hour show.
Focus on the ones that we personally, as a fan, I was just familiar with, and I was a fan of. I was a fan of way, way, way before we started the label.
I definitely appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Thank you again. Yeah, and. As long as I've known you, I've known that you have certain release dates. It's usually like around November time or the early fall, and then maybe in the summertime. I think that's the time frame. But please inform the Metal Maniacs out there on how you developed and when you developed your plan to release new albums or compilations.
Already from the start, we decided that we want to work with annual schedules, and we usually finalize a release schedule early during the year to have our first releases out in April, having them out for Keep It True Festival, where we sell personally, has stayed our sort of a tradition for us. And after choosing the songs for our compendium of metal compilations, which are also among the first releases. Actually, we always number the compilation before the other ones during the year. We basically don't add any new bands or releases to the current year. However, unfortunately, those plans don't always work, as I already mentioned before. And bands are often late, sometimes so late that we not only have to move their album to the next release slot that year, but even move it to the next year. And a few times we still added a new band or a new release when a slot opened, because especially if we'd otherwise we'd have only one release, it's quite important for us to have a minimum two CDs released together, because of all the shipping costs, promotion, shipping out the promo CDs and so on and so on, and distribution, and from the pressing plant, of course. So we always aim to have at least two releases at the same time. And but I think it's still worth to have a plan to try to stick to.
Yeah.
And the compilations, they help us with that, apart from being mostly promotional items, showcasing songs of bands whose albums we plan to release in the current year, as well as the songs of bands whose albums we released the previous year. And we always try to have a few previously unreleased songs there, or songs in alternate versions, like live demo, rehearsal. And a few times, Bands wrote songs, wrote and gave us exclusive songs for these compilations. And compiling them is quite fun, but also challenging, because I always try to pack the CD to the maximum. So most often to have 72, 74 minutes of playing time. Few, I think few, if any, labels nowadays release regular compilations on a physical format now, at least. I know that some bands, some labels release compilations on Bandcamp mainly, but I don't think there is a label which would be putting out, like in the past, Metal Massacre, the series of the compilation series. So anyway, I think it's also a good way to get noticed through these compilations. Right. And we usually print 500 copies, 500 CDs, and 1,000 booklets and inlay cards, so that the following year we use them as a sort of a super flyers, because they are usually 8-page informative booklets, and we spread them at many festivals that we go to. I think just a little stripe with the Bandcamp address where people can always check the music.
That's great. And let's share with the Metal Maniacs a couple of links that they can support the bands on Metal on Metal Records. And I have two links that I think are the best. That would be metalonmetalrecords.bandcamp.com, and also your website. metalonmetalrecords.com/shop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, these are the two places you can buy, under these links, you can buy CDs and digital versions of the albums we released. But, of course, we have also Facebook, where you can follow us, and YouTube channel. We don't post much, we don't upload many videos, but it's mostly around the releases time, so. But you always feel free to subscribe and to follow us there.
I have noticed that about the new releases on your YouTube, Metal on Metal Records YouTube. Check it out. Yeah, definitely. And Yowita, are you currently doing artwork or CD art for your bands? I went to your website. That's Yowita-Kaminska.art, and it said it's currently under construction. So that leads me to the question about that. I wasn't sure if you gave up doing the artwork, or if you still are, or just slowed it down.
No, I haven't given up, but nothing at the moment. No, I'm not doing anything at the moment. And yes, unfortunately, I still haven't gotten around to rebuilding my website with artworks. It's a shame, I know. It was unfortunately lost few years ago, and I have to do it again. one day soon, maybe. But the last cover art I painted was actually quite recent. It was for the new Arkham Witch album, Swords Against Death, and it was based on the band's idea. Sometimes bands have quite clear ideas, sometimes they give me a free hand to come up with ideas. And yeah, hopefully there will be something next year, something new. But right now I don't have any plans yet.
I see.
In general, if a band wants me to paint cover art for them, I usually do it, unless we decide another artist might be more fitting for realizing the idea, a particular idea they have, or I just don't have enough time to do it, because actually I'm quite slow. And quite often bands already have a cover art when they approach us and for releasing their album. In some cases, it's rather unfortunate, as the cover arts may look totally unprofessional, and this may influence our decision whether or not to release it. But in a few cases, when the music was really just too good to pass. We didn't approve the existing artwork, and it had to be done again. So, not that we are 100% satisfied with all cover arts on our releases, of course. I mean, far from that. But overall, I think our releases stand out quite in this regard. Personally, I painted 35 covers for our releases and designed quite a few more with already existing artwork, usually old art from the past centuries.
So you've done 35% of the artwork for your label?
For Metal on Metal, yes.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive.
Plus about the same. I don't know, I would have to count actually, I haven't counted. But I would say in total maybe like 70 cover arts.
Nice.
Yeah, I should. I didn't count actually, but for quite some time. Nice. Not really. I mean, the most famous is, of course, everybody knows it's. Everybody knows this band and this album. Probably it's Exodus, Temple of the Damned. That's the one that. You painted this one. Okay, now I. Of course, yeah. I saw it.
I didn't know that. That's impressive. Yeah.
Ah, you didn't know. Okay.
I didn't know.
The band. You know the album. I'm pretty sure. So.
Oh yeah, yeah.
But absolutely. You know, the other bands are mostly from the underground, or like bands like Manila Road, so they are underground, but already they were already much more known. So Attacker and quite a few others, but anyway. So it's for us, you know, the visual side of our releases is very important in these days. When it's harder and harder to sell CDs, the quality of the product itself matters a lot, in our opinion, and we want to give the fans their money's worth. Not sure actually how many people appreciate it, but we take pride in this work, and it's always great to hear positive feedback about it, which we do sometimes, personally also at the festivals. Anyway, we've always had this idea that underground doesn't have to mean unprofessional.
Right.
And in our opinion, the bands that we choose to work with are above the average underground level, and the releases just deserve the same professional packaging. No cheap-looking childish covers, minimalistic black and white booklets with the 2, 4, or 6 pages, you know, and so on.
I got you, and I agree with you there. And Yuida, at this time, is there anything that you would like to say to the fans of Metal on Metal Records that are tuning in right now? Anything you'd like to say to them?
Be curious. There is so much awesome music out there being created every day and released, that it would be a shame to ignore it and to stick only to a few bands you had listened to for many years. Mm-hmm. And I've often heard people saying things like that the times for metal are bad, there's nothing interesting, etc., while they don't even make an effort to look deeper in the underground where they can find some real gems. And just don't settle with what you already know. And even though I can't argue, of course, that the 80s were definitely the best era for metal. There's no two ways about it. And but also this is why we want to do and we want to and we do contribute to keeping this 80s spirit alive by releasing albums which some of them sound as if they were written in that decade. And what else? I know that times are hard now, of course, especially now in the last couple of years, and for more than one reason. But If you like a band or a label for that matter, and want to survive, want them to survive and to keep releasing new stuff, the support of each and every one of you matters. And whether it's by buying the physical format, which personally for me, it's the only way to consider something a part of my collection. I need to have a physical format. So whether it's by buying the physical format or digital downloads, merch, or going to the shows, or even by something that doesn't cost anything, like interacting with bands and labels, posts on social media, sharing their posts and links to the music, preferably officially uploaded, obviously, and or online shops. Even listening to the music from streaming from streaming platforms like Spotify, of course. That's something I'm personally against, and I would not use them as a fan, but as the label, we should, and we do go with the times, and we make our releases available everywhere for free as well. And well, if you do this, you are helping more than you probably realize, so please start or keep doing it.
Well, Yuida, I want to thank you for tonight being our special guest here to talk about Metal on Metal Records. Thank you for all the information, and thank you for your time, and thank you for being here on the Metal Meltdown on Metal Messiah Radio. This was a special show, especially since your label and Metal Messiah Radio are both turning 15 years old, so that makes it even extra special. And a lot of the things that you said during the interview, I have to tell you, I know LC, the owner of the station, for about 15 years, I would say 15 years. Mm-hmm. Maybe not for the full time of Messiah Radio, but pretty close. And he has pretty much the same philosophy as you. And he, over the years, he has been telling me or suggesting to me to get with bands on your label. I remember bands like Metal Boy. I got with Heretic not, how many years ago was it? Maybe a decade ago.
I think it was 2012.
Oh, something like that. Yeah, it's been a decade. Yeah,
when we
like
released it. The album, I think it was 2012, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's like there's a special bond, I feel, between Metal Messiah Radio and Metal on Metal Records. And I think LC's felt that way from the very beginning. I remember when there was, before Facebook, we had MySpace, and he mm-hmm. would have Metal on Metal Records as part of the page because he wanted to promote it so badly. So he's been a fan of you and the label for as long as I can remember.
That's
so
nice to hear. MySpace long time ago, yeah.
Yeah, so it's been a long time, as I said. I think also the age of both the label and the station have something to do with that, being that you were both new, you know, so I believe that that had something to do with it. So it's been an honor having you here on Metal Meltdown on Metal Messiah Radio, taking over the airwaves, talking about your label, and introducing us to the bands from your entire roster. Pretty much, you know, past and present. So I really appreciate that. And I want to wish you and everyone in Metal on Metal's circle a very good 2023. May you have much success. And I know you say that you pretty much put out like 500 copies. So hopefully you will have to do work extra hard to make more copies. May you sell out of all your releases. Maybe that's a lot of work you don't want to do, but maybe you'll be successful enough that you'll have
No, yeah, of course, I'm always happy if there is an album that can sell much more than 500, but usually it's usually nowadays it's 500 copies is the standard. For some bands we do 1,000. So anyway, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to talk about the label and some of the bands we've worked with and the albums we released. And yes, let's hope for a better 2023. for all of us, and despite the dark times we're currently in.
Yeah, you know, metal music always helps us through those dark times, so sure. Thank goodness that, you know, Metal on Metal Records has a large variety of different kind of bands, different kind of music stylings, so there's really something for everyone. It gets cliche, I say that a lot, but let's go hear some more music from bands on Metal on Metal Records, and let's crank it up.